Let's have you explain this. So we have a living mirror theory of consciousness. We have a something that can absolutely not be decoupled. The way that the individual consciousness, the private consciousness, the organism consciousness, the way that that becomes exists is literally through the fact that it must understand its world, it must understand its environment, and it has an ongoing feedback loop where it's air, food, water, fitness functions, always fitness functions, reproduction, ideas. What are the ideas at the top of the fitness landscape? How can I consume those ideas to make me as smart as possible? Is this kind of your general reasoning over those billions of years and how that is slowly what had been happening?
Yeah, I mean, that's an excellent description of it. But what I would say is that you're right that it can't be decoupled. So the moment that life comes into existence, there's full-blown consciousness. There's full-blown awareness of an environment, and it wouldn't be as complex as ours. You know, if you don't have a retina made up of loads of cells and all this other complexity, the contents are not going to be as complex as ours. But the fact of experience is the fact of experience. And to me, this is... So there's no change in consciousness over the course of evolution. If you could have your atoms rearranged into a single-celled organism, you would be experiencing the world as vividly as you are now. But it'd be a very different experience, but there'd still be an experience of that. And I think something that's... So in this picture, because consciousness is this kind of absolute, pristine, perfect kind of space in which all experiences arise, even though it seems to be separated, you know, there are these different islands of consciousness. Right now, there's at least one over here, and there's one where you are. The character of consciousness itself is the same. It can only ever be the same. So it's like, if you imagine, you know, as these creatures engaging in survival dynamics, we become very concerned with our separation. I become very concerned to differentiate myself from you, and, you know, in order to survive. And so the separation becomes the really important thing. But if you try and kind of zoom out and look objectively, you can kind of imagine if we're all like soap bubbles, like we're made out of the same liquid, the dynamics of evolution and survival would make us obsessed with our separation. But we're all made of the same liquid. This consciousness is the same consciousness. It's a feature of the universe. It's not James's consciousness. The concept of James in my head does not possess consciousness. The organism doesn't even possess consciousness because it's arising through the interaction with the environment. So it's more like you have a single universe with a sprinkling of islands of consciousness. It's like a bunch of eyes opening in one organism. You know, think of the universe as this organism, and where each of us is like an eye opening in it. And in that way, you can see why in this picture, consciousness is still this unified thing, and you can still you can feel yourself to be identified with that rather than your own personal consciousness. And if you imagine, once you have that kind of experience of realizing that, you know, this is usually described as the self being an illusion in spiritual circles. When you realize that and you recognize this character of consciousness, then the moment you die, another eye will open in the universe somewhere, right? And in parallel, there are now these multiple eyes opening. And when you identify with that process, then you realize, okay, I really am that ground of being. I really am just the unfolding of the world and these eyes opening in it, which I think... When I read texts like the Vedas and the Tao and things like this, to me, it fits with the worldview I'm describing. I guess there are some that are quite explicit about kind of mind only consciousness existing. But to me, I get the feeling that the authors of these texts were seeing the same worldview, where a rock doesn't have to be conscious. The Big Bang didn't have to be conscious if they're aware of the Big Bang. But it describes these principles, you know, even reincarnation, right? If you take the Buddhist idea of reincarnation, with the idea, you know, one of the central doctrines of Buddhism is that the self is an illusion. So I don't think you can think of it as James is reincarnated. But when you have this recognition of the selflessness of consciousness, then it's like, well, what's really happening is, you know, to use Rupert Spira's term of the screen of perception or of consciousness, it's like there's this movie of James happening, and then there might be a movie of a frog happening in parallel, and then after I die as well, and then a plant, and the screen is always the same. I absolutely agree with that the character of consciousness is identical, And I think to really grasp, you know, the pace of consciousness in nature, you really need to be familiar with that. And that's why, you know, you can see it as this binary event, that as soon as you have these enclosed living systems, you have consciousness. Instead of a lot of scientific thinking gets kind of confused with wakefulness and sleeping and like, and then thinks of levels of consciousness. And that's where people start to think, well, maybe it gradually evolved. But then the philosophers are like, no, there's no way it could have gradually evolved. That can't possibly have happened. And yeah, so I think this, the kind of spiritual perspective, is actually really crucial in understanding the place of the scientific picture of where consciousness fits in nature.
Wow. Okay. So there's a coexistence that it's always so important. Like Sri Aurobindo talked about this so much, just the utter refusal to cut life in two and to divide it in two. And that if you always keep it at that one, and no matter how you perceive, always at the one, it'll always help. And especially in this sense, like, I think that the idea of an evolution just exists. It just plainly is true. But also at the same time, again, simultaneity being key, where it's like, obviously we didn't have a way to structure meaning. We couldn't structure order out of the chaos as well as we do now. That's just fact. We just didn't have that ability to do it. And now we're structuring order significantly more out of the chaos. Okay, so there's that. So there has been some sort of an evolution of this neg entropy. And now we have this, and it's excellent. Okay, great. So there's that. It's like the whirlpool is, you know, the eternal spiral, but we're here. But then at the same time is that we're holding that perspective at the same time as we're holding the infinite screen of consciousness, and that itself is never changing. Parmenides and Heraclitus really had, from what I understand, this first, like 2,500 years ago, the first realization of both of those things coexisting at the same time. And that eternal becoming and the eternal being at the same time. And like, if you never divide in two, then you get to that. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's exactly. So the way I would say in my picture of the world is that in order to be an island of consciousness, in order to have this kind of, you know, this perfect, peaceful perch of awareness from which you can just kind of sit and observe the world, you know, in the best kind of meditative states, you know, if you can achieve that, where there is just this kind of, it's pristine, peaceful consciousness. In order to have that privilege of being able to look out of the world and have the lights turn on, you need to struggle. You need to struggle to keep yourself together. There needs to be this controlling and trying to make order happen. And it's kind of like, that's just the price of admission. Like that's the bind we find ourselves in. And it's better to kind of come to terms with that sooner rather than later. And it's also why I actually don't tend to think about there being some kind of consciousness outside of this process. Because if there was, not to be too dark, but there would be no point in me continuing to live. If I could live not as an organism that didn't have to feel pain and didn't have to feel hunger and all this stuff, and I could still be conscious, and at that I could be part of an infinite, blissful, kind of unified consciousness, then that seems better. Like, I don't see, this seems to be a mistake, this evolution thing, this life thing. It seems like a silly, like, you know, we're going to return to the one and then be like, why did we do that stupid game? That game was sucked. It just introduced suffering. Whereas in my picture of the world, it's like, yeah, this funny situation we find ourselves in, that it's an amazing privilege to be alive, but it's not free. It's not trivial. It's a truly kind of interesting place to find ourselves in, I think.